Hi. I was reading the chapter by Watchman Nee and the Spiritual Man on the boastings of the flesh. And as I was reading just the first two pages, it occurred to me that our soul is not as depraved as our flesh. And our flesh is defined as the sin of the body and self of the soul. But with the emphasis on the sin of the body, that portion of our flesh is corrupted more than the flesh of our soul. So what I'm trying to say here is that you're not totally depraved. Your flesh is totally depraved, but your soul is not. Therefore, you still have the free choice to accept what Jesus did for you on the cross, and therefore Calvinism is false. I simply ask the question, is man totally depraved or is man's flesh totally depraved? There's a difference. Isaiah 64:6 says, "We have all become like one who is unclean, and all our righteous deeds are like polluted garment. Even the good side of our flesh is not good. We all fade like a leaf, and our iniquities, like the wind, take us away." So I thought I'd just read the first two pages of that chapter and then see what you think. Do the works of the flesh include only what we hitherto mentioned? Are there other fleshly works? Is the flesh now inactivated under the power of the cross? Up to this point, we have stressed what we have stressed has been the sins of the flesh, which are the lusts of a human body. But our attention now needs to be drawn to another side of the flesh. You will recall we stated earlier that the flesh comprises the works of the soul as well as the lusts of the body. Thus far, we have touched upon the body side only, leaving the soul side nearly unscathed. The believer, it is quite true, must rid himself of the defiling sins of the body. But he also needs to resist the works of the soul, for these are no less corrupt in the eyes of God than the sins of the body. According to the Bible, the works of the flesh are two kinds, though both are of the flesh: the unrighteous and the self-righteous. The flesh can produce not only defiling sins, but also commendable morals. Not only the base and the ignoble, but the high and noble as well. Not only sinful lust, but good intention too. It is this latter side to which we must address ourselves now. The scriptures employ the word flesh to describe man's corrupt nature, or life which embraces soul and body. In the creative act of God, soul is placed between spirit and body, that is, between what is heavenly and spiritual and what is earthly and physical. Its duty is to mingle these two according to each its proper place, it make them intercommunicative. That though such perfect harmony may ultimately so that you'll attain full spirituality. Unfortunately, the soul yielded to the temptation which arose from physical organs, thus releasing itself from the authority of the spirit and embracing it instead the control of the body. Soul and body accordingly were joined together to be flesh. Not only is the flesh devoid of the spirit, Galatians 5:17, it also is directly opposed to the spirit. The Bible consequently asserts that the flesh lusts against the spirit. The opposition manifested by the flesh against the spirit and against the Holy Spirit is twofold. One, by way of committing sin, rebelling against God, and breaking the law of God. And number two, by way of performing good, obeying God and following the will of God. The body element of the flesh, full of sin and lust, naturally cannot but express itself in many sins. Much more to the grief of the Holy Spirit. The soul part of the flesh, however, is not as defiled as the body. Soul is the life principle of man. It is his very self, comprising the faculties of will, mind, and emotion. From the human viewpoint, the works of the soul may not be as defiled. They merely center upon one's thoughts, idea, feeling, like or dislike. Though these are focused upon self, they are not necessarily defiling sins. The basic characteristic of the works of the soul is independence or self-dependence. Even though the soul side is therefore not as defiled as the body side, it nonetheless is hostile to the Holy Spirit. The flesh makes self the center and elevates self-will above God's will. It may serve God, but always according to its own idea, not according to God's. It will do what is good in its own eyes. Self is the principle behind every action. It may not commit what man considers sin. It may even try to keep God's commandments with all its power, yet self never fails to be at the heart of the activity. Who can fathom the deceitfulness and the vitality of self? The flesh opposes the spirit not just in sinning against God, but now even in the matters of serving him and pleasing him. It opposes and quenches the Holy Spirit by leaning upon its own strength without wholly relying on God's grace and simply being led by the Spirit. So when I read that, I think to myself, Calvinists are worshiping God by the power of their flesh, so they're not actually worshiping him as God wills. And the other point that I wanted to make is, so the soul, like I said before, is not as defiled as the body. So you still have free will there that you can receive what God did for you on the cross. You have sufficient grace to have the free choice. So anytime a Calvinist says that you never did and you had to be irresistibly selected, you know that they had never given their life to Christ because they believe that they were irresistibly selected. There was not the precursor of the repentance and then the faith to be regenerated. They say they were regenerated, which causes them to have repentance and faith. And that's not a genuine way to give your life to Christ. So I really like the idea here, the point being, ultimately, that you know, your soul is not as defiled as your body of sin. So, that being the case, you still have sufficient grace to have free choice to accept what Jesus did for you on the cross. And therefore, you can rebuke Calvinists as not our brothers and sisters in Christ. Amen.